Network.
Live from Toronto to the world.
Josh!
This is Josh Holiday Live. Talk that rocks.
The public needs to be informed.
Josh might surprise us.
Got an opinion? Dial 647-6-YO-JOSH.
When you hear him, you're like, what?
Josh Holiday Live starts now.
Happy Friday, March 10th. Live. Call us 647-6-YO-JOSH. It's our telephone number. Vertex, you can do that as well. A boatload of stuff coming up on the show today. We will talk about dating dictionary. If you're an older dater, there's some younger terms we'll let you know about. A little bit of daylight savings. Is it okay to take a plate of ribs on the plane and eat it next to your seatmate? We'll talk about movie theaters, David Attenborough, employee discount sales, and questions women have about men. We as men, Brett and I, who is here, we will answer your questions as best as we can about men. So all of that's coming up. It's been in my world, kind of a topsy-turvy week in that I mentioned this last week. My mother is in the hospital getting what we like to call a tune-up. She's had lifelong lung disease, and once or twice a year now, she goes into the hospital for a couple of weeks, and they give her IV antibiotics. A couple of times a day to basically tamp down the lung disease. So that's happening. And while she's in the hospital, my niece came to stay at my mother's house. Initially, my mother was supposed to be here to kind of look after things, but such is not the case. So I've been sort of looking after that side of things. And there's a bit of a broken telephone thing going on in that I took this niece, I went with this niece down to visit my mother at the hospital, and on the way home we stopped at a kind of a little restaurant thing, and you order at the counter and then go sit down. But anyway, I placed my order, and I think the lady said together, and I said, "Oh, no, just that." And then my niece ordered right after me, and she just got a little bowl of mac and cheese. So had I known that she was just going to get a mac and cheese, I would have said, yeah, just put it all together. Or maybe I was being a little bit miserly and not just saying, I'll cover it. But what happened was she talked to her mother out in Alberta, and then her mother talked to my mom's sister, who, from what I've heard, gets information and then somehow it changes in her head to something else. So what happened was, the story was, I didn't pay for this little mac and cheese, but I had already placed my order. Maybe it was a little miserly. So what came back from my mother is, JP, your aunt and uncle are very mad at you. They say you made Mika pay for all of your groceries. So
wow, that's good afternoon, Canada. By the way, just say hello.
So that's the broken telephone.
So it went from a serving of mac and cheese to the groceries.
Yeah, to she
so it was
had
like a
to
game of telephone, as you alluded to it earlier.
She had to buy my entire amount of groceries.
If only that could be, you know, found. You know, if only you could make that come true.
Yeah, I would. If it's going to be said about me, at least bring it to life.
I think so.
But so then I have to like send the message back through third parties. Well, no, he didn't actually do that. Yeah, it was just
a bowl of mac and cheese. It was all a big misunderstanding.
Yes,
this is how families are torn apart, because
of a small side dish of mac and cheese.
Right. All this child wanted was mac and cheese. How old is this person?
She is 19, just turned 19.
That's a borderline case. You can make the case that she's on the hook for her own food.
She's an adult, but I probably should have been
entry
level
adult right there.
I should have been a better host, and
arguably.
But
if you knew that
the cost of
a bowl of mac and cheese, you could have had family peace. You definitely would have paid that price.
My reputation is in tatters over a $2 bowl of mac and cheese.
Well.
My dog is an anxious dog. I don't think I've shown any pictures. He's basically a small beagle, about a 20-pound beagle. And he's always been kind of anxious and wary of other dogs. So if they come up to him, he'll give a loud bark to kind of say, back off. But there's one specific breed of dog that he is, I can't figure out why, but he's really aggressive towards. Like if he sees a variety of this dog, he starts going crazy, wants to run at it and attack it. And so a lot of times I'll be walking with him on a long leash or sometimes off leash. And I have to be constantly scanning the horizon for any of these dogs. So basically, it's a French bulldog.
Okay. And so this beagle doesn't like the French bulldog.
Does not like French bulldogs. And I try to think of why. I try to put some reasoning behind it. Like, was he at a doggy daycare at some point and had a bad incident with a French bulldog?
Right.
Is it their squashed face?
Sure.
Maybe it's because I am kind of anti-French bulldog because they're a breed that shouldn't exist because it's like breathing through a straw when they breathe.
There's a lot of those though. I feel like there's a lot of breeds. No, none of the breeds maybe should exist.
True. But this one in particular is very like health wise. It's the worst for health. And I think part of it, it's become very trendy because I think it was Lady Gaga had some and then celebrity, and then everyone else wants to jump this train.
Maybe.
In any case, my dog, I don't know what the version of racism is when it comes to dogs. Because if it was like, if different breeds of dogs were races, my dog would technically be a racist dog.
It's a breedist dog.
Yeah, he's
but dogs are allowed to be breedist.
What I find embarrassing,
because they can't explain the problem with the French bulldog.
It's just but maybe he has a reasoning. But if he doesn't, then
assume that he doesn't have a reason.
Maybe
that
he's just
breedist. Maybe he was abused.
Maybe it's my parenting where he's caught on to the fact that I'm kind of anti French bulldogs, and maybe he's like, if my dad is like
your
that,
prejudice,
yeah. Like father, like son.
Uh-huh.
The most embarrassing.
That's how it happens. It's multi-generational toxic behavior and thought processes.
It travels down through the generations.
Sure. Yeah, I like a French bulldog. My dog doesn't either.
Yeah.
It's a tradition in my family.
We pass it on down. And if my dog has puppies, well, he's neutered, but he won't. But if he did, the weirdest thing to see or most embarrassing to see for other people is sometimes you'll see dogs that maybe haven't really been exposed to people of different colors. And they start barking aggressively at non-white people. And sometimes you look at the owner and you're like, oh yeah, I get that. Other times it's just, it just hasn't been exposed.
The owner's on the hook for having a diversity of friends.
This is true.
Or
exposing the dog to many things, especially when it's young.
I have a Sheltie, and Shelties are known to be breedist. They only really want to have anything to do with other Shelties.
I didn't
most of the time.
And does he try to herd you? Does he try to get you and the family to go in a specific way?
Yeah, there was one incident where there was like a toddler, and he was much younger. And the toddler was kind of like interested in interacting with them a little bit, and then the parents were kind of like not paying attention, and I just looked at the situation. I was like, this is not going to end well because this child is going to get herded by this dog. But I wasn't I wasn't prepared to control everything at every moment.
Children need to learn sometimes
Well, he was too young to learn. Poor baby.
Poor baby.
And it probably was just like a quick, you know, adjustment of the diaper or something. You know, like the dog just went, you know.
Mm.
Just a quick little like, oh, I'm gonna try to move you. You're kind of a random. Yeah, he wants to kind of try to corral things.
Yeah, well, that's
what they do.
That's their thing. My dog has his nose on the ground all the time.
Oh yeah,
and every spring when the snow melts, it feels like every single year in April, there's a trip to the vet because he's got some kind of like. Issue with his stomach, like he's pooping blood or he's throwing up.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And I always think it's, well, because all this crap has kind of melted and revealed itself. And he just, his nose is so close to the ground that you can't catch him between sniffing it and eating it.
Right.
At least a baby, if it tries to grab something, you have like a foot, a couple of seconds to get your hand in there. I'm a huge fan of David Attenborough.
Okay.
Are you familiar with David Attenborough?
I feel like he hosts nature or perhaps other documentaries.
Yes.
Yeah. So I'm aware abundance of krill him as a attracts other visitors to
the peninsula in the summer. Antarctic minke whales. Their pointed heads and short dorsal fins give them speed.
That's basically
and endurance.
His voice. But he's a nature documentary guy. I think the most famous example is the Planet Earth series and Blue Planet, which I think for the American version they may have replaced his voice with Oprah, which is a sin, an incredible sin.
Interesting.
But he is the just a all around amazing guy. He's 96 years old. So in the back of my head, whenever I see new stuff with him, I'm like, oh God, it's like I have this dread that it's coming soon that this national or international treasure is going to is no longer going to be with us. But maybe they will use AI and he will be with us in.
Come on, man.
No,
you're a broadcaster.
I know.
We gotta have jobs, brother.
I'm not saying I approve, but I'm saying it might happen.
I hear you. I'm just saying you're probably telling a truth that I don't want to face.
Yeah. Well, they did a British survey of hosts, and he's actually the only one I recognize, but almost 30% of British viewers ranked him as favorite host all time. And if you haven't seen, I think any nature documentary that has him in it seems to be elevated a level. It's just he feels like a storyteller as opposed to just some guy narrating.
Right. So you're a fan of his voice only, or is it just the entire package and presentation of his?
Well, the presentation as well.
Of nature.
And I saw recently a documentary that was more about his life, and he's always been sort of a conservationist as well, and he puts his money where his mouth is. When it comes to the cause of the planet and the climate, looking up stuff about him, he's doing a new series in the UK called Wild Isles, which is focused on the British Isles more than anything, and they did six episodes, and the sixth episode, the BBC is not going to put over their airwaves. I think you can stream it, but the reasoning that was given was they were facing pressure from right-wingers because it had sort of a ecological message about farming. So they got pressured so much by these right-wing lunatics.
Oh, they snowflaked. They snowflaked on us.
It's crazy, especially the BBC. It's just if it's actual factual, put it out there. Don't worry about it. The one thing I do find funny about nature documentaries is in telling these stories, they almost have to create motive. In the lion thinks he may, blah, blah.
That's true. That is true. I have noticed that, and that is it's something that it never struck me as it has you, but yeah, we are, what is it, anthropomorphizing?
Yes, yeah.
We're attributing motivations where really, it's because we lack insight, so we have to say something.
Yeah, and I think it's part of it is also his storytelling. We need a narrative like the lion will search for his mate for another 10 years.
My dog is racist because he was exposed.
He was exposed to French bulldogs who gave him a very hard time as a young puppy. Yeah, David Attenborough, please live as long as you can. I beg of you. I keep seeing ads, and this feels like a more and more in the last few years things where they will advertise something like, well, I'll get the friends and family discount this week, this month, get a friends and family discount. Our annual employee discount sale is open to you, the public.
Right.
And I feel like the employees of these companies would have a right to kind of be annoyed because part of the perks of working there, the job, is having access to stuff that the public doesn't have access to. So if you get like this huge employee discount, you can kind of be proud of that and be like, yeah, that's sort of, you know, I work at Ford, I get cars at a huge discount. And then when you see this car company advertising, hey, you get the employee rate.
I had access to the A plan at one time.
Did you? Yeah, it's I think it's fairly
through Ford.
Notorious.
That was yeah.
But if other people, if anyone can get it, then what? It's not an exclusive thing. It's not really.
Well,
a
they
job
should just
perk.
Make an even deeper discount for the employees during the time of employee discount.
Yeah, but then the ad council is going to say, "Hey, that's false advertising. Employees can actually, you're kind of stuck." But it used to be a thing. Correct me if I'm wrong, but you could kind of help out friends. Like if you work for Ford, you could kind of help a friend get a discount. No. Or is it strictly just the,
Remember if that was an option. Family members of mine could buy a new Ford
family.
Through the
okay.
A plan also.
Yeah.
But not friends.
Okay. Yeah. But extended family, which is
yeah,
still pretty great.
Yeah, I could get immediate family members in on that. But I mean, you know, I'm not trying to buy a new car. I want to buy a used car.
Yeah, I'm the same way. My car that I drive now is, God, I think it's 15 years old. I got a Toyota Yaris, which is weird for a big guy. But I had a Toyota Echo before that, and I don't need a big.
You're in a big city, though. It's helpful to have a small car.
Yeah, it's really good for parking. It's good on gas. So I got it in 2008. As a new car when I was working at a radio station, got like a pretty sweet deal on it. And there's been times where I've thought, I should get a new car. Because it doesn't have the backward cameras and some of the fancy stuff that the new cars do.
Right.
But then on the other hand, I think, why add a new payment to like, why pay more? It's low on insurance. Why get into that? Plus I'm kind of, not that I'm a careless driver, but I'm less kind of, I get less upset if someone's door dings my car because it's like, it's already kind of beat up.
You drive an 08 Yaris.
Now, here's the thing though, to give you an idea of how little I need to drive in this city, I think I just cracked 60,000 on this like 14 or 15 year old car.
Yeah, I also drive a 2008 Toyota.
Okay.
Yeah. And it's, it's got 140,000 miles on it, and I'm not interested in replacing it anytime.
Well, and that's the thing. Like, I saw it when my sister had a Toyota before I did, and it lasted so long, and it was so low maintenance that I was like, okay, you'll get one, and so far so good on this one.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're a Toyota manufacturer or person, please send money to us immediately.
Yeah,
for
please
our,
send money, of course.
Unsolicited plug. It is Josh Holiday Live. We will come back in a minute to answer women's questions about men. Now, if you want to call, if you're a lady listening and you want to call in with any question that you would like a man to answer, you can call 6476-YO-JOSH. Otherwise, we will answer some of these questions that we found and try and help you understand the male psyche, the male sexuality, just dudes in general.
You all know that thing you use to send text? It works for actual mouth talking.
Josh stuff.
Get in on the conversation. Punch 6476-YO-JOSH to be heard. Talk that rocks. Josh Holiday Live.
Yes, as promised. Questions that ladies want answered by men. You can chime in with your own at 6476-YO-JOSH. 6476-96-5674. So Brett and I will try as best as we can. There's also some scientific information provided in this article as well. But the first question that ladies seem to want to know about men is, do you enjoy foreplay?
Of course.
Well, that's a straight answer. I'm the same way. When there was actually a Canadian study that found women would like an average of 19 minutes of foreplay while men wanted 18. Another found men who engaged in extended foreplay experienced fewer sex problems. I will say this. I don't know where foreplay begins, like when you first start making out and then, you know. It begins
during the day when you're interacting.
You think foreplay, this is like conception. You think foreplay begins when you're just chatting?
That's what a therapist would tell you, that, you know, you're.
That's part of the foreplay.
Yeah, I mean, everything of the whole day should be pleasant, right?
Okay, but here they're saying 18 and 19 minutes, so I have to assume that. Like
statistical anomaly.
Their foreplay is less psychological, less.
The statistical analysis has not captured psychological foreplay. Yes, I agree. Yeah.
Okay, so I think when you first start, like as soon as you touch, I guess.
I get a stopwatch out.
it's handy. They say that it actually, we said that it makes it easier for guys to have less problems. And I will say that. I'm not great at just, like, jumping right less in.
Problems.
I need to, like, build up. Yeah. I need some time to kind of get warmed up to the idea. One study suggests that men enjoy foreplay more than women. A third of the male participants wanting it to last longer than 30 minutes. One in 10 men say they'd happily linger there for an hour or more of foreplay.
Okay, that's, you know.
I guess if you don't have a TV.
Whatever diet of this that people want to serve, I'm into it.
If you have a question you would like a mannish answer to, you could.
No, women, that's the thing. They don't need us to. They have, men are lining up to explain these things to women.
We're mansplaining for.
There's no mystery for men.
Okay, well, here's another question. Is it true you're so obsessed with sex, you think about it every 7 seconds? Now
can't get anything done.
That's like an urban legend, maybe, or a fairy tale, because it used to be, men are so horned up. Every 7 seconds, something pops in their head about sex. Remember? Do you remember Adidas? Do you know what the Adidas was short for? Is said to be short for?
No.
All day I dream about sex.
I've never heard that. How fabulous.
Maybe it started as all day I dream about sports. I don't know. And we'll talk about Adidas in a little while because they're in trouble. Okay, so yeah, is it true you're obsessed with sex? 54% of men said every day or several times a day. 43% said
they think about it.
Yeah, a couple times a week.
They only think about it twice a week? Now that's too infrequent.
No. I mean,
they're thinking about it every day.
It's always kind of there.
It has to be the case.
And there's so much stimulation in this world if you're watching.
Of course.
What's the biggest sexual turn off for men? I think anything odorous.
That's pretty bad.
Odorous.
Wasn't even going to go there. I was just going to be like, well, they only talk about themselves. That's the biggest turn off.
That is a little bit. Yeah. But I think odorous is or really unkempt, unclean.
I feel like you're all in the same category there.
Yeah, sort of putting some brackets around a bunch of things.
You're just giving different accounts of cleanliness.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah.
This is another question from ladies to men. Must we deep throat for it to be good.
Welcome. Are you getting out of school? Sexy 960.
Yeah. I don't know. The answer, I think, is just no.
Yeah.
I will make a confession here. I don't like that act in general.
Great.
Receiving or giving. Okay. How much control do you have over
when you happen?
When it becomes firm for the kids who are listening.
Oh my gosh.
And the answer is we don't have a lot, especially if you're like a high school dude or a college dude.
No, it was the worst.
No, it's like you have to find reasons to stay sitting down. Or you do
there were times,
Or you sort of do that leaned over crouch or kind of, yeah, it's not a good situation. Although now it's sort of like, now it's a good thing if it does happen, let alone happen spontaneously. How do men feel a woman's grooming should be down there?
How do men feel the grooming? I feel like there's as many opinions as there are options.
There is. They say that for younger guys, they would like it to be smooth playing, whereas the older guys are more. And I would agree with this. Older guys are more into the, just keep it nicely trimmed. You know, not too much, not too little, just right. Yeah.
I'm not picky.
And finally, women ask men, can you tell if we're faking it? It doesn't really matter, honestly.
Again, that would be situational.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a case-by-case basis, I assume. One person's fakery may be inferior to another person's fakery.
This is true. But, I guess if it was really obvious, it was, like, way overdone, you might be able to tell.
Right, yeah.
There's really no actual physical way that you, like, a man, at least, you know, for the most part, whether it's happened.
Outward indicators.
Yeah, there's no outward indicators that it's actually it's been complete.
Yeah.
All right, so those are just some of the questions women want to ask men. Sadly, a man of a certain age still on the dating apps.
Yeah.
And so there's some more slang terms that have come out. Tinder, the swipe right dating service, has... launched a dating dictionary to help older singles decode the love language used by Gen Z.
Thank you, Tinder.
Yes. You're providing a very good service.
Good. Because otherwise I was going to have to read about it in the New York Times.
Eventually. So one term is called cushioning. You want to guess what that is?
Oh, what is cushioning? Would that be like when you're wanting to go out, but just in between serious things?
Okay. Well, it's basically keeping several backup relationships to soften the blow if the main one doesn't pan out.
Okay, that's not too far off. All right.
This one seems like it's entered the vernacular in a widespread way. Situationship. Not quite a couple, not quite a hookup, somewhere in the middle there.
Oh, I see. You're like a regular friend with benefits.
But not quite a couple. You're just in a situation.
I feel like friend with benefits was always, that term already exists.
It feels like that's probably what it is. Yeah, situationship is the new Gen Z's version of
FWB.
Friends with benefits.
Yeah, so.
Date view. Do you know what a date view is?
No idea.
Okay, well, it combines two words, dating and... it's basically combining interview and a date. So it's when a date feels like the person's being interviewed. Like,
but again, I mean, some people that was already happening.
Yeah, but now they put a term.
They implied that you were trying to get to know this person.
Yeah, so now they've come up with
and
a
just
word.
Depending how aggressive you were about it, was whether or not the interview was going to happen.
Okay, how about this one? Kitten fishing. It's not cat fishing. It's kitten fishing.
Okay.
So kitten fishing it refers to tweaking or embellishing certain aspects of your life, your appearance, etc., to make yourself more appealing on dating apps. So it's not cat fishing because you're not pretending to be someone else entirely. You're just kind of
So that's what. So makeup. If you put on makeup that day, that was kitten fishing. Yeah, this cannot be. This terminology.
It must be too detailed. It must be a deceptive thing where you change stuff about you that's actually not quite
well.
True.
He colored his hair before, but now he's let it go gray.
He has no hair. Even
he was kitten. Well, that yeah. I guess that's a catfish.
Yeah, a kitten.
I'm saying kitten fishing is just you change the color or you stop maintaining it.
Yeah, but I think it's the kitten fish is you are that actual person, but you've just changed a lot of details about you. All right. This one is dumb. Riz is short for charisma. So who cares? Hey, you've got a lot of Riz.
R-I-Z.
Charisma. I guess if you don't want to use three syllables, it's a lot of work. Saying charisma.
He's got that Riz.
Charisma. Three. Yeah, you can just say, yeah, that guy's got the Riz, man. Oh, he's got Riz.
But it sounds like a disease.
Yeah, that's right.
It sounds like an affliction.
That guy's got the Riz.
He's got the Riz.
He needs some penicillin.
Yeah, watch out for that.
Take care of that, ladies. When's the last time? I know you kind of live a somewhat rural life. When's the last time you saw a movie in a theater?
That's a great question, and it's it's been 5-6 years, probably. I went to see the Ford versus Ferrari. I saw that in the theater at Christmas with my brother-in-law and my father-in-law.
Okay, and that.
But before that, it had been another 6 or 8 years. So I've been like once in a decade, probably.
Wow, that's.
But I used to go a ton.
Same. So, and that's a good example of a movie that probably is better experienced than the Ford versus Ferrari
in
theater. I used to cover movies, so I used to go along like a lot when I was doing entertainment stuff. And at one point, there was a theater chain here that would give to some press. You would get this card, like the famous card or whatever, and because it was famous players. And this card, you could go to any movie in one of these theaters anytime with a friend for free. So that lowered the bar of seeing bad movies and good movies. We would just go to every movie, no matter how bad it might be, because it was free. But
before, I mean, did that spoil it for you?
A little bit, but before
that's what happened to me.
Before the pandemic, I would go.
Oh, that's recent.
Yeah, that's within the last like 3 or 4 years. Before the pandemic, I would go, you know, on occasion, especially if it's a movie that's best enjoyed, either because it's an audience film where you want a lot of people there to experience it together, or it's a film that's more reliant on big visuals and big sounds. Though I will add a caveat here that I'm not really into blockbuster movies in general. I like more sort of smaller story movies. But,
yeah, it does seem like, you know, something happened in Hollywood where over the last 25 years or so, more explosions, more action, more fighting, less story and less dialogue. But that's because the international market became so much more important for their bottom line to actually make movies make money.
This is true.
And so all those things that you want are no longer found in the marketplace.
No. Well, I think they moved to like streaming services. You find some.
Well, yes, that's it's now known as appointment television, I guess, or binge worthy something.
I didn't, even though the pandemic's not over. Let's say that, but even Fair though enough. Things have loosened a little bit, I was the one movie that was almost got me back was I don't think it's a guilty pleasure. I just like it. It's the Jackass movies.
Okay.
I don't judge too much.
When that showed up on Earth, I was into it. I watched it. I want to do it.
No, you watch vicariously. It's just like kind of fun, cringe.
But at a certain point, they got old.
Yeah.
And then they're still trotting them out there, and then some of them have died. Yeah. Then there's like a schism where they don't all get along anymore. So now you got like the Jackass dregs coming along, going like, come on, man, come back out, Brett. Come on, get this going. And I have to just go like, I got old.
Well, they've now recruited like a next generation
younger dudes are getting kicked in the nuts.
Yeah. But it's that's the kind of thing where it's not fun if you're just kind of sitting alone on your couch watching it. I mean, it's kind of like a crowd.
I like art house movies to also, this guy got turned over in a porta potty.
And he got poop all over him.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it was just riveting.
That's like my music taste is goes from classical to Motorhead. Anyway, so apparently during the pandemic, 2,000 movie theaters in the U.S. have closed down.
Yeah.
But
they were on life support to begin with anyway.
Oh yeah, yeah. Especially as the home theater technology improves and
the movies just got more and more expensive. And the movies themselves, I've seen all the plots.
Yeah.
I know what's going to happen.
Well, you watch the 2-minute trailer and you're pretty much.
There's that too, but I mean, you're sitting there and like, okay, this is going to happen and this is going to happen. And, occasionally you would get surprised.
You're not one of those guys who says aloud, like, oh, you know what's going to happen? Like a movie predictor where you'll say to the person next to you, that guy's going to get killed or that guy's going to get caught.
I would tend to do that, yeah.
Oh, no. Well, don't. Yeah. I'm not going to watch a movie.
No, I'm terrible in the theater. What I really want to do, though, ultimately, is make fun of the movie if it's bad.
That's a joy. Well, there's movies like The Room and that are specifically like played for audiences knowing that they're bad, like they have cult followings. I've found one of the reasons I don't go to like movie theater movies anymore is because people's theater etiquette has gone so bad that I'm almost anxious watching a movie. Like if someone opens their phone and I see that light, I used to take to until they got rid of pennies in Canada. I would throw pennies at people who would open their cell phones in front of me.
Oh wow! Just I've never been so aggressive.
Hey, put your phone away.
No one would know that that was a punishment.
I think if you're on your phone and something like knocks you on the shoulder or like if something hits you, you'd be like, oh wait a second, why am I?
I don't know. I feel like the people are just going to keep doing whatever this is they're doing and be like, oh, a penny.
The worst
is from heaven.
The worst is having like talkers behind you. So if you go shh, then you kind of have your back to them the rest of the movie.
I mean, there's so many potential problems. There's that. There's the popcorn crunchers. There's the people. I mean, I've seen, it got so bad at one point. I just sit there with my buddy and I look over and in the armrest between us, a bare foot has emerged through. Just right there to be like, ugh. Everything you don't like about the earth is happening to you right now.
I remember I was in a movie once sitting behind this group of like 50-something, 60-something ladies.
All right.
And it was Midnight in Paris. So it was shot all around Paris. And I guess this lady had been on a trip to Paris in the last like 2 or 3 years before watching it. So the whole time she's like, oh, yeah, that's where I went there. And I was like, shh, shh. And this – I don't think she knew, like nowhere along the line had anyone ever said to her that when you go to the movies, you have to shut the hell up. It's not a place to be talking. You shut up. And I kept shushing her.
The etiquette has gone down, but they were old enough that they should have known better.
Yeah. She was at that point. I was like, okay, I'll go get an usher, but then you're missing like 5 minutes.
You're saying that she was so caught up that she was just expressing.
Yeah, she was like pointing out locations that to her friends that I guess she had been.
Oh, I've been there.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that's yeah. Blah, 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 blah. And she even after I was right behind her, and even after shushing her a bunch of the time, she just kept going and like was angry, like it was her right to jibber jabber away during this movie. So 2,000 movie theaters closed in the U.S. And what you mentioned actually earlier about international. Movie money makes sense because they found that an extra 12,000 theaters opened in overseas screens.
There you go.
So they're still and they're saying the average movie price, even though it seems like it's a lot more, they adjust for inflation. So movie in 2022 was actually less than in 2019 and 1971.
Well, it makes sense that it would be less than 2019 because we just went through a great, shrinking of the industry. But since it's less than in 1971,
with inflation, so the average price right now in the States is $10.53 average. So in 1971, adjusted for inflation, the average movie cost was $11.92. So
okay,
there you go. We talked about this a little bit earlier. The Adidas having issues. Adidas, basically, when Kanye came out as basically being a Nazi sympathizer, you know, we all knew he was a trashy human being, but he took it to next levels when he became.
He just kept talking.
Yeah, he kept talking and
It didn't get any better.
Not a bright guy. So Adidas, it took them a while. I guess they were trying to get their damage control ducks in a row before they pulled the plug. But now they have this issue where they have $1.3 billion worth of Yeezy shoes after they broke up with them. I didn't know it's a German sportswear maker, but apparently it is. CEO Bjorn Gulden said that if they sold the shoes, they would be paying money to royalties to Kanye, and destroying them could raise sustainability issues. And the other thought I had, which I realized was correct here, I thought, well, why not just do what they do with the T-shirts of the Super Bowl losers, send them to third world countries. But they say here that's a problem because there's a market value to them. They would end up coming back here, you know, sold for profit.
But there isn't as much of a market value as there was.
Well, right? That's for sure. Yeah, because if you're buying them now, you've got to know that you're essentially saying, yeah, I'm okay with that.
I was only aware that he had a contract with Adidas after he boasted that it could not go away. I didn't even know he had his own shoes.
Yeah. Like they're pretty popular. Someone else
they're
said
ugly as hell. As
yeah.
I
oh yeah.
Them now.
Yeah. Someone said
they look
that,
like they're melting.
Yeah. They basically, yeah, it's basically, it looks like someone put clay on their foot and put lines on it.
Yeah. It's like all these swoops and then they got holes in. They look like, what if Crocs were designed by aliens?
That's an apt description. I was saying maybe, well, company can maybe recycle them. I would say like maybe relabel them, give them to like, give them to third world companies. All right. This applies, I think, to any kind of form of public transit, but there was a lady who was on an airplane and a guy came on, sat in the seat right next to her in the middle seat. And he opened up and ate a big package of ribs, corn, and chips. Is that okay or is that not okay? 6476 Yo Josh is our telephone number. Is it okay to bring out your home food, especially if it's sticky or smelly, on a form of transit and eat it? Let us know.
Something bugging you? Oh, yeah! Need to vent?
Where the f*** is Josh?
This is your unfiltered megaphone.
When you hear him, you're like, what?
Dial 6476-YO-JOSH now to be heard. Talk that rocks. Rocks. Josh Holiday, live.
Yes, live. On the home stretch, winding things down here, Josh Holiday Live. Is it okay that this dude brought a big pile of wings and corn and chips on his flight, sat in the middle seat?
Oh.
I don't know. I'm kind of like, if it doesn't stink, I'm okay with it. I think if he brought like deviled eggs or an egg salad sandwich or something fishy. I've talked about this before that I don't understand how anyone could eat deviled eggs or egg salad sandwiches simply because it's what a fart would look like if it was a physical thing.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
That's a physical,
it's
visual
embodiment. Yeah, like I can't eat egg salad or deviled eggs because my thought process is I'm eating something that stinks like a fart. Like I'm eating a fart. Which is unpleasant.
It doesn't smell good.
I mentioned this in the past, but I took a day road trip with my mother, and she had the idea that she was going to bring along for herself some egg salad sandwiches in the car.
That's just not practical.
So I think as long as if it's not stinky and you're not getting like rib juice or rib sauce all over your neighbors or your seat, and you can keep it contained.
I mean, it is a funny thing to try to eat. I don't even like to eat ribs in public, just on general principle, because they're messy.
Yeah, messy foods are embarrassed to be seen eating in the best of times.
I will make an exception for wings because everyone else at the place, if it's a wings place, is eating wings.
Yeah.
And so the messiness is just an assumed risk. Right.
Everybody is wing night. Everyone's
equality there. Yeah.
Yeah. Same thing if you're going to going to medieval times. Everyone's eating with their dirty, filthy hands, and it's okay.
Indeed.
Should mention this Saturday night, daylight savings time. We are spring forward, so you're going to lose that valuable hour of sleep. And we have some factoids here. The idea of daylight saving time, first proposed in 1895 by a New Zealand entomologist. Nobody was interested. It didn't catch on. A guy in London in 1905 proposed it. And the reason was he was an avid golfer who hated cutting short his summer rounds on the links. Idea did not catch on. The Germans and their allies first to implement daylight savings time as a way of conserving coal during World War One.
All right.
Britain and a bunch of other countries followed. U.S. adopted daylight savings in 1918. It wasn't until 1966 that the whole country observed it. And all Canadian provinces were on daylight savings time by the 1970s. So this is
something that you've been compelled to accept
for a long time.
The Americans.
We're out of time, but that whole debate about, go ahead, go quickly.
Well, the last time they tried to change it, they expanded it, and I think it was in the early 2000s because the barbecue grill lobby wanted it a couple more weekends of grilling.
That makes sense. I there's talk of just getting rid of it altogether, and I say I'm for that. In any case, the big message here is don't forget to set your damn clocks forward on the weekend, and we'll see you next week at our new time. Well, the same time, but it will be it'll be lighter out. That's what we're trying to say.
Turn on the lights, open the shades.
The show's over, but the conversation continues. On Twitter at Josh Holiday, on the web at joshholidaylive.com, and hear missed episodes on your favorite podcatcher. Talk that rocks. Josh Holiday Live.